Let us stand for our call to worship. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Our opening hymn is the great hymn, Come Thou Fount. Activities this week, again, due to the coronavirus for safety. Most of the restaurants in town are closed, but if you have takeout, our grocery stores are open, and you can take advantage of those things. Also a great time to reconnect with family and with your church family. Pick up a church directory that you have at home and start calling people. Tell them you're thinking about them. How are they doing? Is there anything they need? Call and let me know if there is something someone needs, or if you're aware of something that I am not. You can call me, you can text me at 770-329-0126, or you can email me anytime at pastor.ravengappresbyterian@gmail.com. The Finance Committee has asked that I make an announcement that even though we're not together and the offering in this service is a little bit different, you can continue to give and support the work and ministry of the church by sending your tithes and offerings to the church P.O. Box. It's Raven Gap Presbyterian Church, P.O. Box 333, Raven Gap, Georgia, 30568. We're working on online giving, PayPal, Venmo, and all of those fancy things. Right now, a check in the mail is probably the easiest way. We continue to work and serve both the music department and I as pastor with checking on each and every person, planning worship, visitation where we can and when it's possible, and a lot of iChats and telephone calls. We look forward to being back together in a more normal, traditional way very soon. But until then, thank you for watching us online at our website and at YouTube. Anthem will be during our offertory, and let us now pray. Loving and merciful God, we give you thanks for this day to be able to worship in a different way, but worship in a way that is similar. It is our normal liturgy. It is our normal order of worship. It is our great tradition as children of God to come and worship each Sunday, celebrating the miracle of Easter throughout the year. As we come to the end of the season of Lent and the days ahead, Lord, we pray that you have focused our attention upon you, upon the wondrous ministry of Jesus Christ, and helped us to look forward toward a triumphal entry, a difficult and painful betrayal, an arrest, a trial, a crucifixion. And may we long for the power of the resurrection, because it is in the power of the resurrection that we live and we breathe and we hope, for we are an Easter people. Lord, we pray for our world that is troubled, troubled by a microscopic virus that has brought great powers to a standstill. It has slowed the factories. It has stopped an economy. It has changed our world in many ways. What we knew and took for granted, we now miss. What we know now, we greatly appreciate. Lord, we pray for the people of the world that are suffering from and battling this terrible illness. We pray, Lord, for a cure, for successful treatment. We pray for a virus that will be able to be stopped with a vaccination. We pray, Lord, for flattening the curve, for social distancing working, for spreading out the cases so that our hospitals and doctors and nurses can handle those who are sick and give them all of the care that they need. Lord, we pray for the families that have lost loved ones, a growing number of people around the world who have an empty spot at the table. We pray, Lord, that you will give them comfort and that you will give them strength and guidance and peace, both now and the days ahead. We pray, Lord, for those who have symptoms, those who are awaiting tests. We pray that the test will be negative. We pray especially, Lord, for the frontline workers, for those in the hospitals, those who drive our ambulances, those who treat patients in the ER, the doctors, the nurses, the hospital administrators, the staff, the orderlies that must clean up and sterilize and disinfect. We pray for those who are putting their own lives on the line, that you will protect them, that they will have the equipment they need, that they will be spared any illness. We pray, Lord, for our leaders to do better, to work together, to be focused and not distracted, to show compassion and empathy. After all, they are called public servants. May they serve the public more diligently now than they ever done before. Lord, we pray for our own communities, our families, our friends. If we could only put a protective bubble over each and every town, each city, each community. Help us, Lord, to be wise. Help us to wash thoroughly, to disinfect, to take this seriously, not only for our own protection, for our own health, but most importantly, for those who are at risk, those who are older, those who have underlying medical conditions, conditions that we may not know of nor see, but it puts them at great jeopardy. Lord, give us wisdom. Wisdom in the laboratories. Wisdom in the university research hospitals. May we unlock the mystery of this virus. May we discover a vaccination. May we deliver a cure in record time. We pray these prayers and the silent prayers of each and every person's heart. In the wondrous, mighty, and loving name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now bring to God his tithes and our offerings.
Going home, going home, I am going home, going home, going home.
we give thanks for these, the generous gifts of our time, our talent, and our tithe. We ask that you will use it, that you will bless it, that you will multiply it to serve and to meet needs that we know of, needs that we do not yet expect, and the needs that we cannot imagine in our ministry to serve Christ and represent all that is good in our community and beyond. We pray this in Jesus' wondrous name. Amen. This chapter includes three parables. It is a very long discourse in Jesus' ministry, probably outside the Sermon on the Mount, one of the longest passages that we have of word for word Jesus' words. These are parables. They are earthly stories with heavenly meanings. First, Luke 15, 1 through 7 is the parable of the lost sheep. Then it is followed by the lost coin, and then we close out the chapter beginning in verse 11 with the parable of the lost son, or maybe more well known, the parable of the prodigal son, or just the prodigal son. Listen to God's word as Jesus tells this story. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. And not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, and he set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. And so he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to the fields to feed his pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have good food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and he went to his father. But while he was still a long way away, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son and he threw his arms around him and he kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against you, heaven, and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And so they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants and asked them what was going on. 'Your brother has come home, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry. He refused to go in, and so his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now is found. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. The cover of your bulletin today is a painting that hangs in St. Petersburg by the Dutch master Rembrandt. You know you've arrived as an artist or a musician when you're just known by one name, you know, Rembrandt, Elton, Cher, Aretha, Willie. Rembrandt, he was born the 15th of July in 1606 in the Dutch Republic, now we know as the Netherlands. He was the ninth child born to his parents, the ninth child. His family was pretty well-to-do. His father was a miller. His mother was a baker's daughter. Religion is a central theme in virtually all of Rembrandt's paintings, and the religiously fraught period in which he lived makes his faith very interesting. See, his mother was a Roman Catholic. His father, in the midst of the Reformation, was Dutch Reformed. He was a Calvinist, I'm going to say a Presbyterian. While his work reveals deep Christian faith, there is no evidence that Rembrandt formally belonged to any church, although he had five of his children christened in the Dutch Reformed Church in Amsterdam, four of them in the Old Church and one of them in the Southern Church. The French sculptor Rodin said, "Compare me with Rembrandt, what sacrilege! With Rembrandt, the colossus of art. We should bow ourselves before Rembrandt and never compare anyone to him ever." Vincent van Gogh wrote, "Rembrandt goes so deep into the mysteries that he says things for which there are no words in any language. It is with justice that they call Rembrandt a magician." That's not an easy occupation. This is a story. This is a story, as we have come to know and expect, of the prodigal. There are three main characters: the younger son, the father, and the older son. There are some supporting characters, some friends that are nothing but parasites and leeches. There are some maybe sort of wild, promiscuous women. There are some good times. There's some alcohol. There's some parties going on. And then there are tough times, not really friends at all. There is a pig farmer. There are some pigs. And eventually there are true family friends and neighbors that come together to celebrate what was lost being found, a prodigal returning. The word prodigal is a noun. It means a person who spends money in a reckless, extravagant way. A person who leaves home and behaves recklessly, maybe, but later makes amends and repents. Having or giving something in a lavish scale. It can also be an adjective. Spending money or resources freely and recklessly. Wastefully extravagant. Prodigal habits are hard to kill off. It has synonyms. Wasteful, extravagant, imprudent, immoderate, excessive, intemperate, irresponsible, self-indulgent, reckless, wanton, spendthrift. Wait, spendthrift. That gets my attention. I have been confused all these years considering a spendthrift as was someone who was miserly. They were tight with their money, with their spending, but it actually means the opposite. A spendthrift is a person who spends money in an extravagant, irresponsible way, often money they don't have. The Reverend Tim Keller uses a different title for this story. He wrote an amazing book called The Prodigal God. Our Tuesday morning men and women's Bible studies, The Iron Men and the Steel Magnolias, just recently studied this parable for 3 months through the lens of Keller's book. Keller turns the story upside down. I will admit myself that this has never been a parable that I liked. Why, do you ask? This is, after all, a classic story of Jesus' own telling, from his very lips to our ears. It is also a story that is commonly known even outside the church. It is a story that the very central character's title as a prodigal has become part of common speech and language around the world. I still never really liked it. The parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. That is maybe the greatest opening line to a story outside of, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness, it was the spring of hope. It was the winter of despair. Sounds a lot like a description of today in many ways, but it is from Dickens' 1859 novel, A Tale of Two Cities, as I'm sure you know. Or what about, it is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. From Jane Austen, 1813 masterpiece, Pride and Prejudice. Or the pure and simple, beautiful, Call Me Ishmael, which begins Herman Melville's 1851 adventure, Moby Dick, or the line that cannot be taught, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There was a man who had two sons. If you had sisters or brothers, Jesus has your attention. If you are a parent and have more than one child, Jesus has your attention. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Ouch. Can you feel the sting of those words? Even if not a parent, this younger son is saying, Dad, I don't want to wait until you die. At the best, that's what he's saying. At the worst, he is saying, I wish you were dead already. Give me my share now. I'm sure this father was one of some means, but likely, like many people, it was probably tied up in land and investments. He probably had to liquidate, sell off, maybe at a low point in land or investment values. He would have had to pay some taxes, I'm sure. That issue has always been and always will be. This wasn't an easy write a check and send the younger son away moment. Verse 13, not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and he set off for a distant country and there squandered his wealth in wild living. Anyone over 40 would have predicted that, wouldn't they? After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country. He began to be in need, so he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him into the field to feed his pigs. This young son, this young man longed to fill his stomach with the food that the pigs were eating. The pods that the pigs were eating looked delicious to him, but no one gave him anything. The ultimate journey down to the very bottom. It is a predictable story in many ways. We have seen it. We have watched it on Entertainment Tonight or TMZ. You have seen the rise and fall of many a person, even on the nightly news. This journey is to the bottom. Nothing was lower than swine to the Jewish people that hear this story as told by Jesus. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? Here I'm starving to death. I'm going back. I'm going to go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and he went to his father. I imagine the journey was hard. He was hungry. He was tired. He was dirty. He had lost everything he had. The younger son was in such a desperate situation. He is ready. He is willing. He is expecting to hear, I'm sure, I told you so. But he doesn't even care. He doesn't want his room back. He doesn't want to sit with the family at dinner. He wants to just be a hired servant, as he knows that his father's servants live better and eat better and are treated more justly than the situation that he has put himself into. But while he is still a long way off, His father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son. He threw his arms out and around him, and he kisses him. Not the reaction expected by this rude, ungrateful, and foolish young man. The father, however, is filled with compassion. He ran. An uncommon and undignified thing to do back then is he would need to lift up his robe and expose his naked legs to run, his arms out, not crossed, but out, waiting, hoping to embrace. Son probably expecting arms crossed, father looking down his nose, wanting an apology. Instead, his arms are wide open in a swooping up, a carrying away of, an embrace, a kiss, a welcome home. The son said to himself, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." Repentance spoken. Even though it wasn't asked for, that's important. Repentance spoken, even though it wasn't asked for. The father could see and the father knew. Still, for the son, it was important to say. It had to be said. Confession, repentance, and apology is spoken for the sake of the one who sinned more so than the one that was sinned against. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet, bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast to celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found. And so they began to celebrate. This is not just a simple welcome home dinner. This is a feast, a celebration with family, friends, neighbors near and far. I expect this wayward child's mother was running to fix all of his very favorite dishes, his favorite sides, his desserts to go with that fatted calf. Meanwhile, scripture tells us the older son was in the field. And when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. And so he called one of the servants over and said, "Hey, what's going on?" "Your brother has come," was the reply, "and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." We know what happens next. The text says the older brother became angry and refused to go in. You hear where the older son was. He was in the field working, as he has been doing every day of his life. He's doing the right thing. As he comes in from the hot and dusty field, he likely hears some music faintly, and then it grows louder until he realizes it's coming from his house. There's smoke rising up. Somebody's fired up the grill. He is a little confused. He doesn't know what's going on. He begins to smell the most wonderful foods being made. He sees cases of wine being opened and brought in. And finally, as he arrives at the house, he hears laughter and celebrations. And he asks, "Well, what's going on?" And he doesn't like the answer he gets. He becomes angry. Maybe he becomes jealous. I like to think that he becomes very hurt. He backs up from the doorway. He stands under a tree. He won't go in. And so his father hears that he's outside and comes out to him. He meets him where he is. His arrival and reaction are interesting. Again, an insult and a rude son, but this father tries. He goes out and hears this faithful and hard-working older son out. The text says that, so the father went out and he pleads with him, but he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed you. And yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours," and you can hear the disgust in his voice, "when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him." And then those closing words to a story better than any story I can think of ever written. He says, "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we have to celebrate. We have to be glad. Because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now is found. I never liked this parable. I never liked this earthly story with a heavenly meaning because I am guilty of being the older brother. In my mind, it isn't fair, it's wrong, it's unjust, but in time, I became a parent. And when I became a parent, I saw this story in a very different way. I was able to move out of my role as the firstborn and put myself in the place of a father. Which child of yours, no matter what has been done, would you not rush to welcome home or give thanks that they are alive, safe, and well? This should never have been called the parable of the prodigal son. Jesus does not give it that title. Editors later, publishers do that. It is not in the text. It is a story of a man who had two sons, is what the text says. I argue that this should not be called the parable of the prodigal son. I argue it should not be called, as Tim Keller says in his book, The Prodigal God. This story is the story of the good father. It is an eternal illustration of no matter what we do, no matter how far we run, we are but just one step back into the everlasting and loving arms of our heavenly father. We all are looking at life a little differently right now. We are isolated. Our church is empty in the pews, and if you've ever been able to worship with us, that is not the way it is. Our church is packed to capacity. We are struggling to find folding chairs. We are in need of bigger spaces and new buildings. There is excitement and joy on Sundays in this place, in the mountains of Northeast Georgia. But today there is an empty sanctuary. The pews are missing all of the faithful, all of the regular, all of the members, all of the attenders, and many visitors. Last week when we did this for the first time, it struck me, it hit me. It didn't hit me till I started the sermon, the difficulty that it would be to look out and not see empty pews as I thought. The difficulty is to look out and see your faces where you should be, and you are not. This story, this parable, is an eternal illustration of no matter what we do, no matter how far we run, we are but one step back. Yes, life is looking a lot different right now. We are isolated, we are self-distancing, we are fearful at times, maybe anxious, the news is on more than it should be, and we are worried about things unknown and unseen, and we are feeling out of control. At a moment like this, I and every minister of Jesus Christ must share the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God given up for our sins upon a cross so that we can come home. No matter what we have done wrong, like the younger, no matter what we have done right with the wrong attitude, like the older, this isn't something that we have earned. It isn't something we deserve. This is an open door. No, this is more than an open door and an invitation. This is Jesus running to meet you and embrace you and give thanks that you have come home. This is a celebration. It is a feast you're invited to. It is a feast that you can rejoice and relax and celebrate. You don't have to worry about who made it and what conditions and were they wearing gloves when they touched the spoon. This is a feast of joy, of bounty, of goodness and richness. We are looking at life differently, more cautiously. I dare to say preciously and beautifully, as the gift that we took for granted seems now much more valuable than it was a week or 2 weeks or a month or before Christmas. So in your own life, where do you find yourself in the story? Younger child, older child? Have you lived life long enough to have a sense of the feeling of the parent? We are all on the outside, separated from the family by our sins committed and the good we have failed to do. We are all on the outside waiting, or refusing to go in. During this time of awareness, this time of focus, this time of isolation and distancing and separation, may we use this to reach out, to repair, to restore, to right any wrongs, and may forgiveness be more contagious amongst us all. I pray with all my might this virus will be stopped. I pray that not another soul will be infected. I pray that those battling will be cured and spared. I pray for those on the front lines of treatment and research. I pray for supplies to be created and provided and plentiful. I pray we won't waste any more time. More than Purell, which cleans our hands, may we welcome and accept the grace of Jesus Christ, whose life and death and resurrection cleanses our hearts and makes us part of the family and brings us home. This is a parable of a good and faithful and loving and accepting parent calling us and welcoming us home. In other words, as the Apostle Paul says it in the 8th chapter of Romans, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Through him who loved us, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The door is open. The invitation has been given. God says, come home. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for an open door, for a porch light left on, for your eagerness and watchful eyes looking for us in a distance, ready to run, ready to embrace, to sweep us off of our feet, to hold us tightly, to let us know that it will be okay. Lord, in a time where we are afraid, give us strength, give us hope, and may the love that you gave in Christ Jesus be shared, be caught, transform, and change the world. As we have time, more time than we expected, and less time than we imagined, may our energy and focus be on making things right, calling those we love, saying we're sorry, saying we appreciate them, saying we treasure them, saying we look forward to and long to see them, and we are preparing for a heavenly feast given to us by the Master, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is Softly and Tenderly. Let us stand together. Of my mentor and friend, Dr. Frank Harrington. He had a way of putting things in perspective, of making you feel safe, and it was okay, and God had this. Today, I will close with his benediction, because it is one that makes me feel safe. It is one that comforts me, and I have pulled words out of it and used at bedsides and hospitals around the country to comfort, to strengthen, and to guide. When I pray bedside, I pray for the comfort of the family members who are gathered there, for the strength of the patient who is going in for a procedure or an important surgery. I pray for guidance for the medical team as they deliver the healing touch of Christ. There are times where the person isn't getting better, and we are nearing that point of departure, that graduation to the church triumphant. The prayer then changes, and that the comfort is for the patient, the strength is for the family to carry on, and the guidance for them to live their lives as they have learned through Christ and their family members' faith that they have loved. So today I do pray for comfort for not only our community, but our nation and our world. I pray for strength for those who are fighting a terrible illness that we have not yet solved how to beat. And I pray for guidance for the doctors, the researchers, the scientists, and those on the front line each and every day. And now, go in peace. And remember, by the goodness of God, you were born. And remember that in the mercy of Jesus Christ, you have been redeemed. Remember that he walks with you every day, to comfort you, to strengthen, and to guide. He promised he would. Lo, I am with you always. Remember that while others have called you servant, he has called you friend. And in the strength of that mighty friendship, go forth now to serve in the Master's name until we meet again. Amen.